It's a must read for every seeker. So in this room, we have like almost a room full of seekers. We have that curiosity. What is this? One of my friends, she has written a book. There should be something in it. So we are all seekers already. And this book, it calms and clarifies the inquisitive mind. We have a lot of these existential questions. What's the purpose of my life? What am I running behind? Why am I in this rat race? And am I doing the right thing? And am I doing the right kind of sacrifices? Everything. So this kind of, it calms you down. And definitely I would say it's worth the read. So when she first shared, I thought it was a light-hearted reading. They let me start, let me support my friend. That's how the first few lines of the book started. But then more and more I read it, it got more gripping. Because there's a lot of personal connections that you can make with this book. With every page that was turned, it was kind of shattering all the superstitions that you have in your mind with science-backed logical reasoning. Because I'm a science person, and in today's world, we don't trust anything where there is no science or technology backing to it. There are a lot of quotable quotes in this book, which puts things much easier for us to understand. Like for instance, one thing which stuck in my mind was, it said that tapping into this universe is science. Tapping into the self is spirituality. I felt it was so beautifully put together. And another one which was so apt was, science, it's all about what is this? What is matter? What's the space? What is universe? What is this? That. So that is science. So similarly, spirituality is, who am I? Because who am I is the most difficult question to answer. Everything else you can find answer in Google. And Siri can give us a whole bunch of great details. And Alexa is always there to help us with finding answers for questions which have an answer already. But who am I? That is something which we have to dive deep within and find, what am I here for and what am I trying to figure out in this world. So a lot of questions, your burning questions, it gets answered as you read the book. And this book, it has like a lot of snippets of knowledge in highlighted boxes, which gets more and more crystal clear when you read and reread and reread. You'll be able to connect with a lot of things that happen in your life. That was timely. So those highlighted texts, that kind of summarized every chapter, and those bunch of words, it kind of sticks in your mind even after 2 or 3 days after you read the book. So that's the point. I felt like this book is much more than a piece of knowledge or literature. This is like a spiritual book with self-help tips. I can clearly see the changes in me before miniature and after miniature. With everything that you do, you take the book along with you. You take the knowledge that's in the book with you day in and day out. So that's the kind of help that I received from this book. And all the picturization in the book, it puts the perspective. So because in a spirituality book, and all Indians, we have heard lots and lots of discourse. They make things very complex, and at the end of the spiritual discourse, you come home not knowing a word of what they tried to express. You're totally confused, or you have more questions before attending the discourse. But in this book, it has a lot of pictures, like especially talking about chakras, yoga, meditation, enlightenment. It's so hard to put all these knowledge in a picture form. So those pictures, she has worked really great on them, and it creates a big impact on the mind. So I love looking through the pictures to understand it much better. She has answered about the guiding guru. A lot of us, we have like a lot of doubts about it. Is a guru needed? And guiding guru, what do they do? And I feel like more than the guru itself, this book and the author Kalpana, she has been a guiding star for me to lead me to the guru, to understand my guru better. The Hindu deities and Hindu gods, that's a very sensitive topic. So most of the authors, they kind of avoid it. Why do you have to even touch the topic? So in this, a lot of like scientific reasoning has been done, has been explained before the behind the reasons of why we do what we do. The chapter has been sequenced in the right way. So when you reach the last chapter, which is the Varnashrama Dharma, the first line says it's like unlearning and learning about Varnashrama Dharma. So we have seen this, how we have been like categorized as FC, BC, and in India, a lot of things, you have to go through this filter. So in education and in the day-to-day life, we all have experienced it. And we, some of us, we have like great amount of anger towards it. And why me? Why am I in this Varna? Why is this happening to me? So it was like a total concept of unlearning what I knew already and then learning what exactly, why it was formed and what's the meaning behind. So I would say if you are into at least a little bit of search for inner self, and if you are looking for inner awakening, I would say this book is a must read. And thank you, Kalpana, for sharing, letting me share your journey. Thank you.
So, first of all, I would like to congratulate Kalpana on the release of long-awaited miniature. And also thank you so much for giving me the privilege of reading this book. Thank you. So to me, miniature, it's really a blessing because of a lot of reasons, but I would like to share at least a couple of them here. Miniature is the answer to a lot of questions that related to spirituality, karma, and also the purpose of life. Not only that, it gave me so much knowledge about the things that I never knew about, and also I never thought just by reading one book I would get that kind of knowledge. So that's what miniature did. And then the second thing is what actually miniature taught me, you know. So it taught me how to look for positivity in everything and to be positive. So by doing that, applying that in my day-to-day thing, so I just happy inside, more happier inside, and more content, and also more peaceful, you know. So these are the things that we wouldn't get just like that, but by following something that strongly impacted us. And also it taught me how to deal with disappointments or any failures that happen in day-to-day life, you know, in a good balanced way. So yeah, so miniature, I'm sure when you all read, it will bring a new dimension and new thing to your life, which you can apply in every day-to-day thing in your life. So Kalpana, once again, thank you so much from bottom of my heart for giving miniature to us. Thanks everyone for coming.
Hi, my name is Ganesh. I work for an IT company based out of Chennai, India. So I had the privilege to read the wonderful book, The Miniatures. Thank you for giving me the opportunity, Kalpana. First of all, congratulations, Kalpana, for a tremendous effort. And it's not easy to pull off something like that. What is amazing about this book is, this book talks about, you know, mind, memories, energies, chakras, annamaya kosha, pranamaya kosha, and then it talks about astrology, talks about significance of Shiva, Om, significance of Ganesha, Murga, yajnas, mantras, name anything from the mystical and spiritual world, there is nothing that book has not touched. How did you make this magic? How did you create this magic? The essence of this book is, if you understand yourself, you understand the whole universe, isn't it? I mean, you know, you are the miniature of this universe. I would say, if you read this book, you have read all the spiritual book in the world. And I'm not exaggerating, guys, I really feel it. Because when you read, there is so much is covered, it's definitely a magic that I think only Kalpana can do this. Another interesting aspect about this book is the kind of analogy or anecdote that Kalpana has used throughout the book. you know, because you have taken something, a very abstract concept, and you need such anecdotes and analogy to support that, you know. Communication is all about how much you simplify what you're trying to say so that anybody can connect to what you're saying, you know. That way you have done a fabulous job in this, you know, be it elephant analogy or a Ramosomo to communicate about the sweetness, tasting sweetness and experiencing and talking about it. That says volume about a spirituality where, you know, preaching spirituality or talking about spirituality is different from experiencing it, you know. And the way how you explained about the science and spirituality and how they complement each other, fabulous job. I can go on and on. I mean, there is so much to talk about it, but I leave the others for to experience and enjoy reading the whole book. Once again, great job, Kalpana, and good luck with the release. Bye.
Thanks for taking time to be here. I'm proud of my wife's effort and achievement. I remember, like, you know, we have been talking about our future plans, where we want to go. I know that she had a knack for writing. And she started the blog after that and then released two books. One in Tamil, our native language. And the other one is an e-book on Amazon in English. This is the third book, but most arguably, like, you know, this is one of her best books or important book, I would say, because it intersects the different dimensions of well-being trends like yoga, meditation, mindfulness, and also it can help your day-to-day life and, you know, in a better way to enhance your day-to-day life and also, you know, lead a stress-free life. Thanks again. You know, I'm excited. I don't know, I have no more words. I want to make it short. I'm about to release the book and I'm happy that it's happening after so many years. And I would thank everyone again. Have a blessed rest of the day.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you so much for taking time to be here. It's a cold afternoon, but surrounded by warm hearts, a cup of hot tea, and a book to talk about. What more to ask for? Thank you all once again. And every single creative work on this earth has always had influences from others. So I want to offer my thanks for all those influences, because that is how we acknowledge our dependence. We grow and we help others grow through our dependence with each other. So before I start with miniatures, I want to take a couple of minutes to honor and thank a few people here. So firstly, I would like to thank Mr. Rasi Tambi. He's a professor here at Madathil. Sir, can we have you here? And without him, this event here would not have been possible. So I want to take this opportunity to thank him for all his support for making this happen. Thank you, sir. Next, I would like to thank my dear friend, Mrs. Patricia Chandrasekhar. She has always been a pillar of support throughout in my journey in writing and even otherwise. Anytime, anywhere, any help, I can just pick up the phone right away and she's there. So I want to thank her for all the support, and thank you, Patricia. It really means a lot. To these people, I want to thank Kalesh Shankar, Meera and Anand, and Mr. Ganesh Rao for taking all the time to read through the book, and then sharing their knowledge here with all of us. And that's truly appreciated. I'm grateful to all of you. Thank you for walking with me every step in this journey. Thank you so much. Next, I would like to quickly thank my miniature launch team members, Vijaya, Aparna, Aruna, Kale and Meena. I know they reached out to many of you here. So thank you so much, and thank you Vijaya for heading this effort, and I would like for you to come here and accept the honor on behalf of the team members. Thank you so much. I have something for you, but I didn't.
Here's an example. The same energy in us
that is expressed as love, when distorted, shows up as hate or fear. It's the same energy. So when one is expressed, others are not. So love upside down is hate or fear. So all we have to do is just turn it up. Right? Love, hate or fear, the choice is ours. So if we are all energies and if the entire universe is all energies, how about we do some task here to see if we can feel the energies around us? Shall we do that? Okay, it's a very small task, it's very easy. Some of you might have done it, but we just want to do it together to see if we can feel the energies around us. Okay, I'll give you the instructions. And then we can all do it together, okay? So this is what you will do. You have to take both your palms and then rub against each other. So I'll give you the instructions and then we can all do it together. So take both the palms, rub against each other, and then you can shake your hands, put your fingers together, and then put it like about half a foot apart. And we will do this with our eyes closed. Put it half a foot apart, close your eyes, and then I'll tell you what to observe. Okay, shall we do that? Okay, so let's take both our palms and rub them together. Rub, 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 rub. Okay, shake your hands, fingers together, and bring them like about half a foot apart. Close your eyes, just half a foot, okay? And stay there. Close your eyes and feel the tingling on your palms. And slowly start feeling the resistance between your palms. Just slowly start feeling the resistance. And very slowly and gently, little bit try to push your palms towards each other. Very little. And the more you push, you will see more resistance. Right? And the closer you get, the denser the energy gets. Okay, stay there for a while and just observe the resistance. And when you really feel the resistance, you will feel that as a ball of energy. If you feel that, you can start playing around with this ball of energy. You can rotate your palms gently and feel the palm, the ball of energy. And you can lift both the palms up, the ball of energy will come with you. And then you can bring it down. You know, you can feel, you can play around with this energy. So, let's slowly put our hands down and open your eyes. Did you all feel it? Yes? So, this is just tip of the iceberg. How great would it be if we can feel our own energies in our own chakras? And then work on them and bring them to balance, right? So that's just a simple task for you to feel the energies, okay? Next, I have a question. I know some of you meditate here, but my question is, how many of you have sat down to meditate even once? If you sat down, close your eyes to meditate, never mind if the meditation did not happen. Even if you tried once, trying to meditate, how many of you did that? Wow, almost all of you, right? Have you observed that when you sit to meditate, there are too many thoughts flowing, right? And very uncontrollable, so you give up meditating. You think it's not for you. How many of you have had this experience? Okay, many of you, right? So why is this too many thoughts uncontrollable? We are not able to control the chattering mind, right? This is a million-dollar question. Even now, as I'm talking to you, you have so many thoughts flowing in your mind, right? So how to control these thoughts? One way is to instruct your mind. Have you ever tried that? Instructing your mind. Tell your mind, don't do this. Have you ever tried? Yes? Okay, so we are going to do a small task here. And we are going to see, we are going to instruct the mind and tell it what to do and what not to do. And see what it does. Okay? So this is called, okay, before that I need to tell you, there's an example that I wanted to say. So every time you hit the snooze button, not able to get up, right? It happens to all of us. We are absolutely determined. When we set the alarm clock, we are absolutely determined. We want to get up this time, but we end up hitting the snooze button again. Right? Have you observed, have you listened to the mind talking? It tries its best can to convince you to not wake up. Okay, it will give you so many numerous excuses to not wake up. And you will be so convinced. So you will not wake up. So this happens, right? The mind talks to you. So this is what we are going to do. And this is called the red monkey test. Okay? There is a red monkey somewhere around here in this hall. And I don't know, it might be under a chair behind me, but it's definitely here somewhere in this hall. So what we need to do is, it's again another simple task. You just have to sit there, close your eyes, and we're not going to meditate, don't worry. Okay, it's not a meditation session. You can close your eyes and enjoy your thoughts. How nice this is, right? Just sit there, close your eyes and enjoy your thoughts. Maybe about 20, 30 seconds. And you have to instruct your mind and tell the mind to do one thing. There's just one condition. You can think about anything in this world, but do not think about the red monkey for the next 20 to 30 minutes. Okay? Sorry, seconds. Because if you do, it's going to come sit next to you. Even if there's no chair, it's going to come next to you. So you are not going to think about this red monkey for the next 20 to 30 seconds. That is all you have to do. Right? Not even a minute. So this is what we are going to do. We are going to close our eyes. We are going to first instruct the mind. Tell the mind strictly. It's your mind, right? So it has to listen to you. So tell your mind strictly not to think about the red monkey for the next 20 to 30 seconds. And then you can relax, sit back, relax, and you can enjoy your thoughts, your weekend plans, whatever you want to think about. But first instruct your mind and then so let's do that. Close your eyes first, instruct your mind. Tell the mind not to think about the red monkey for the next 20 to 30 seconds. And I will tell you when to open your eyes. You can slowly open your eyes. How is it? Good? Did the red monkey peep in? Once? Twice? Thrice? Four times? Many times? A million times? You know what? When I did this exercise for the first time, when I opened the eyes, my eyes, the red monkey was almost sitting on me and holding me tight, and we became that close. Okay, so what is the takeaway from this task? Other than the fact you now have a friend to take home, what is the takeaway from this task? If you instruct your mind directly, it's not going to listen to you. You tell your mind, don't do this. You tell your mind, do this. It's just going to do the opposite. The more you resist, the more it persists. Right? The more you do not want to think about the red monkey, the more you are thinking about the red monkey. Did that happen? Yes. So how to stop my mind from chattering? The only way to stop your mind from chattering is through our breath. Right? What is the first thing we do when we are born here? Breathe in. And the last thing we do when we leave this world is breathe out. And all we do in between is breathe in and breathe out. However, little do we realize that. We just take our breath for granted. Right? Okay, so it's only the breath which can be used to control the mind. We know where our heart is, right? We know, and we started a little late, so I'm just moving a little fast. If that's okay with you, right? So we know where our heart is, we know where our lungs are, we know where our brain is. Do we know where our mind is? Have we ever thought about that? Do we know where our mind is? Our mind is a subtle layer that encapsulates every cell of our body. It surrounds each and every cell of our body. That means The thoughts which arise in our mind is also going to encapsulate every cell of the body, right? Obviously. If our thoughts are negative, it impacts not just our mental well-being, but also our physical well-being, right from each and every cell of our body. Is that right? So, breath as it travels through the body, what does the breath do? As it travels throughout the body, it cleanses the mind, it gently sweeps away the unwanted thoughts, and it protects every cell of our body. That's what breath does. So we see motivational speakers and writers talk about positive thinking, right? We've heard a lot of people talk about positive thinking. Think positive. Okay, but how? Right? You can think positive. Thinking positive is definitely going to help you. But how are we going to do that? Can I ask my mind to think positive? No, we just saw that, right? I tell my mind to do something, it's definitely not going to do that. So if I tell my mind to think positive every time, it's not going to work. So infusing positive thoughts by removing the negative thoughts directly in the mind is not going to work. So there is no instruction manual for the mind. Wish we had one. But unfortunately, there is no instruction manual for the mind. So all we have to do is focus on the breath a little bit, put a little bit of effort there, and you will see the magic happen. So, we all undergo emotions, right? We have anger, fear, happiness, sadness. So we go through all these emotions in our day-to-day life. Have you observed how our breath is with each and every emotion? When we are in anger, our breath is short. When we are in fear, we run out of breath. Right? And when we are happy, our breath is steady. And when we are in meditation, our breath is slow, deep and steady. So what do we see here? We see that breath has patterns. There are some patterns with the breath. With your emotions, the breath changes. So with some time-tested breathing patterns, what you can do is remove the unwanted thoughts, wash away the negative emotions, and take care of your mind. So the mind is back into harmony. So we will do 1 minute small task. Because what is that we saw now? We said breath controls your thoughts, right? So can we do 1 small task to see how breath can control your thoughts? Okay, it's very simple. It's easier than the other 2 tasks. All you have to do is nothing. Okay? You only have to breathe in and breathe out, and which is what you're already doing, right? But it's a specific breathing pattern, very simple breathing pattern that we are going to do. Okay? This is what you will do. I'll give you the instructions. You will take a deep breath in, and we will do this with our eyes closed. Okay? And the reason we do all these tasks with our eyes closed is because to take our focus to what we are doing. Because when you open your eyes, you get distracted. Right? So we will close our eyes, take a deep breath in, hold it for 3 seconds and then let it go. Okay, we are going to observe our breath now because otherwise normally how we breathe? We don't care, right? We don't observe it. So now we are going to observe our breath. We are going to take a deep breath in, hold it for 3 seconds and I will count it for you. Okay, I will do the counting and then you can let go. Okay, and now when you're holding that, in that stillness, I want you to observe your thoughts. That 3 second stillness that you have, observe the thoughts. Okay, let's do that. Close your eyes, put your palms on your lap, facing up, and eyes closed. Take a deep breath in, and let it go. Okay, now take a deep breath in. Hold. 1, 2, and relax. Okay, if any of you missed observing that stillness, let's do it one more time. Eyes closed. Take a deep breath in. Hold. 2, 3, and relax. Yeah, you can open your eyes. Did you observe your thoughts in that stillness? Yes. So we had, do you agree, you had no thoughts or very less thoughts in that stillness? How many of you agree? Many of you, right? So what happens is, you saw now. So breath controls our thoughts. So that's just a simple task. We need to realize how breath can control our thoughts. So through some breathing techniques like pranayama, doing it on a regular basis, we will slowly and steadily train the mind so that the mind gets trained, and then any time during a day-to-day life, you are not going to have too many thoughts because you've trained the mind. You know, you would have heard of this half elephant. It's tied with a chain to a pillar for many years, and when the chain is removed, the elephant still thinks it cannot move, right? We would have heard about this. This is because the elephant's mind is trained for so many years that it cannot move. So everything is easy. We can just train our mind to bring it back to its nature, because that is its nature. The nature of the mind is that. But we lost it for so many years, so now we have to train our mind to bring it back. Right? So, miniatures has four parts to it. Part 1 and 2 talk about energies, mind, breath, chakras, karma, dharma, our emotions, how to balance them, and so on. It also talks about yogic personality development, which is like a new term to an existing process. But I want to place a disclaimer here. This is not a religious book. Okay? In part 3, you might see images of gods from India, but that's the most interesting part. Because you will see the secrets of ancient Indian wisdom unfold in your palms. You will see how all the lines connect together in one dot. Right? So all that you read in part 1 and part 2 about the energies that you read will all make more sense in part 3 when you read part 3. It will all fall in place. And I don't want to say anything further about part 3. I leave it for yourself to experience yourself and explore. And we are coming to the end. The part 4 of this book is the climax of this book. Okay. Part 4 talks about the most challenging topic in today's world, social discrimination. Right? Modern psychology says that the impact caused from pain, physical pain, is the same as the impact that comes from the pain from social rejection. Do you even believe that? That's what modern psychology says. So the social discrimination in India, the caste system, is what this last chapter talks about. And if you're thinking, if you have imagination of what it's going to be there, that's not what you're thinking. That's not what it's going to be there in the book. If you're thinking what yoga, meditation, energies and all that we talk now, how is that connected to the caste system? Hold on to your questions, because that's a climax. So no spoilers here. So I want you to read the book and explore it for yourself. Right? So with this, we come to the end of the book overview. And I will open the floor for questions and answers. Thank you.
So,
hey, Kalpana. First
yes.
of all, congratulations.
Thank you,
Shari. On your book, launch. It's very nice briefing about your book and what you explained there. As much as we all know, we are all grown-ups here. I see most of us are almost grown up in India, little bit know about these chakras and all this stuff. But I would like to know, in nowadays, our children, the second generation, third generation, are here going to the colleges and schools, right? Is this book anyway useful for them? Because my observation is, and then we can go back to our scriptures and read, being grown-ups there, the kids who are grown up here are already in a lot of stress. There is way too many things or information available to them that makes them more confused, and they still have very hard goals to reach. They have to compete twice than what we competed when we were growing up, right? So I think any element in this book is useful for the younger generation, if you can explain. Thank you.
Thanks, Shanta. I definitely think part 1 and 2 will definitely help them. Because I don't think, part 3 and 4, all they they come together. When you read part 1 and 2, then 3 and 4 come together. But for kids to answer your question, part 1 and 2 definitely. Because the problem is in today's world, in schools, they don't teach us how to handle stress. Right? And we see, I never heard of the word stress till I was like, you know, when I got married, till the time I got married. But kids, children in these days, no, I didn't mean that. Maybe, yeah. You know, sometimes the truth comes out even without you realizing. But I'm just kidding. Okay, so to answer your question, definitely part 1 and 2, because it talks about stress. I mean, we have only little time here to tell you what the book covers, but it definitely talks about stress and how to handle stress. It talks about yoga and meditation. See, the thing is, we think yoga means the physical postures, that's the beginning and that's the end. But that's not what yoga means, right? Yoga literally means bringing into union. And the children at that age, whatever age they are, they don't have to understand the technical description of what yoga is. But they have to get into this practice of being yoga and meditation. The book does not talk about any techniques as such, but the book explains the benefits of yoga and meditation, breathing and all that. So definitely part 1 and 2, you should make them read.
So basically you are saying, here's the reasoning why you should do it.
Exactly. Okay. We know the reason because we are in stress, but it tells you how it works. That's what we don't know, right? Because kids today, they look for logics, and if you try to explain to them, see this is how it is, and then it talks about it's like we saw some small tasks here, right? You will see more of it in the book, so maybe they'll understand better.
So, do you have any other questions?
I have a comment, and I'm going to go out.
I see, I'm coming. But I'm going to stop here first. Young lady, what's your name?
Sloka.
I love your boots. These have got to be the coolest boots ever. Do they come in 10 and a half? Awesome. Who has a question? Sorry, I got all distracted on shiny things. It's happens.
Kalpana, I was just wondering if you could give us, you said in the book it doesn't talk about any exercises per se, and I know the importance of deep breathing, but can you give us one example of what we can do every day as far as deep breathing and how long we should do it, how many minutes a day?
Two things I can suggest to you right away is you can do pranayama, which is like holding your breath that we just saw. You can do that, saw that how it works, right? You take a deep breath in and then you hold for a few seconds. You usually hold for 4 seconds and then you let go. That is pranayama. And then the other thing that you can do is alternate nostril breathing, which is called Nadi Shodhan. And you can Google that and you can see YouTube how to do that. So that's like doing on one nostril, closing the other. So you would have heard of alternate nostril, right? And what that does is it balances the nadis. So I don't want to get too much technical into it. We have the Ida and Pingala nadis on both the sides of us, on the left and right side of our breathing, when you breathe in on both the sides of the nostrils. So it balances the Ida and Pingala nadis. So you're breathing, when it balanced, you know how breathing helps, right? When the breathing is balanced and the nadis are balanced, when there are no blocks in the nadis, then obviously you get clarity in thinking and focus on what you want to. No, it's all, that one is through the nose. There's another one which is called Ujjayi breath, and that is what we breathe through our mouth. So this one is all nose. Yeah.
Thanks. Did I see another hand in the front right there? Do you want to show it to you?
Stephen, after that, there's someone at the back too.
Okay, congratulations on your book.
Thank you.
I started the meditation process a year back, and it's been a wonderful journey. And join and get through the process. So in the book you mentioned that this is a spiritual book and not a religious book. For the benefit of myself and for everybody here, could you elaborate the difference between being religious and being spiritual? I mean, I am learning, I understood, but like I said, for the benefit of myself,
I'll do it very quickly, because you know, Neera and Kale, they know I can talk for hours. So I will do it very quickly, the difference between spirituality and religion. And that's a very good question, because many of us think spirituality and religion, they are synonyms for each other. So it's not, right? So religion is man-made. Okay? We know that. right? It's only after Jesus Christianity came and only after Buddha Buddhism came. So religion is man-made. But spirituality, if you're here living, breathing in and breathing out, then you are a spiritual being. Because spirituality is no way connected to any God or any religion. So religion is only a means to get you there. It's like a road that leads you there. You don't even have to have any religion. You can have a new road for yourself and get to the destination. But it's not that I'm saying no to religions, but that's the difference.
So Kalpana, congratulations. And I know
thank you.
When people are going to read the books, they're going to come up with a lot of questions and a lot of introspection. How am I going to change my life for the better and all that? So is there a next step that you're looking for as the next step for this book? Is there some kind of a website or a group or something that you're envisioning that you can help when people have these questions?
We already have a Jack spirituality group. How many of you are there? We can raise your hands.
What's the name of that again?
Jack spirituality group. You can join that group and we do a lot of exchange of these knowledge. We have knowledge sessions. Many of us here are in that group. And or in the book I have an email address. You know how to reach me if you know me. And you can send out an email to me if you have any questions, if you want to know about more about a particular topic in the book, or if you have any questions, just reach out to me. And feel free if you want to join the Jack Spirituality group. We just meet maybe not like once 2 months, 3 months, it's like ad hoc.
Can you send me the
I will do. Yeah. Yes, Lina.
What made you write this book? Did you experience something and you want to write this book as a service or something?
Okay, like as Steve mentioned when he was introducing me, right? I always believe knowledge is meant to be shared. Right? It's communal, it's meant to be shared. So that is the reason for writing this book. But as far as miniature knowledge goes, as I said, miniature was born in science.
Congratulations.
Thanks, Kalpana.
I know Kalpana for several years. We worked together in EC, you know, in JTM EC. And even at that time, I know Kalpana is in a different level than everybody else. So,
hopefully,
it's been great to see you there. And, you know, I can
see
that. We
used to fight a lot.
that's one thing, like, you know, when people, like, need money or something, like, if one person has a lot of money, one person don't, you can always go and get it somewhere. You can even win a lottery or something like that. You know, if you have something more, you can always get it one way or another. But the knowledge, and then this education, and then the power of knowledge is something, you know, you cannot just get it. It's somebody's got to spend some time, and then dedication, and focus, and then somebody's got to build like that is something, you know, only the person has that dedication and commitment can do that, and you've done that, I can see that just now.
Thank you.
And the question, I have a couple of questions for you anyway, congratulations. You know, the meditation, the spirituality and all this stuff, like, people have been talking for several years, you know, from the Stone Age, right? So, when you collect all that and write a book, right, what is different, or what are you trying to convey from, you know, whatever, you know, people have been talking for years? That's kind of one thing, and then also, what will be the key takeaway reading your book? If I read a book, like somebody like me, you know, I'm in a lower level, if I read a book, what will be my takeaway? Is there anything you can say?
Okay, I'll answer your second question because I forgot the first. You have to remember. Okay. The takeaway from this book is, I wouldn't say one thing, because truth is multidimensional, okay? It's 360 degrees. With what perspective you read this book is one thing. And I don't know what channel it's going to open within you. Right? It can tap into any particular channel. And you never know after you read this book what kind of transformation it's going to give you.
So that is the reason I cannot say what is one particular takeaway from this book. But what is there in the book is from my own experience, I can tell you that. It's not like I borrowed it from a different book or I read somewhere. It's from, I would say, like, see, when I talk about chakras, we all know about chakras, right? It's not I'm telling you something, we have this many chakras. But the other thing is, when I talk in the book, what a chakra does is from my own experience. And that is the purpose of the book, because I want to share this experience with all of you, because I know we are all in need of it. So I don't know if I answered both the questions.
Probably gave us some more to think about. Anybody else have any other questions? We want to go have some people sign to close.
Or one person.
Okay, can't do that. So, how do you think you did? No, you got to hold up just 1 second. We're closing this thing up, maybe this is for you. All right, how do you think you did? How do you think you did?
I think I did good.
Nervous?
And thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for coming. Have a wonderful day.